If you think you don't need a brand to succeed in your business, you're crazy. I'm Andre Minkoff, the founder of Trademark Factory. And in this video, I'm actually going to go through a few extracts from an amazing book by Harry Beckwith called Selling the Invisible. The whole book is great. You should get it if you're selling any type of services. But there's a chapter there that deals with brands. And some of the things he shares are crucial for you to understand. And I'm just going to go over that and maybe provide some of my comments as well. So I'm just going to, like I said, going to read some abstracts from it. And this may not be the most logical order because I don't want to read the whole thing. One, it would be getting close to copyright infringement, which I don't want to do. And two, there's really no value in me reading the whole thing. So like I said, I'm just going to be going through the book with some of the ideas that I think are worth sharing so that you can go out there, get the book, and also when you see how crucial it is for you to have a brand in your business so that you go out there and build that brand. So let's go do this. Don't make me laugh. It's tempting to create a clever name. Sometimes this temptation becomes so strong that you give your service a slightly funny name. Let's say Hair Apparent for a hair transplant clinic. Here's a test that will talk you out of this mistake. Look up one of those weirdly named services. Chances are it's a hair salon or a pizza place. Go there and go in. You will notice two things. We have never been there before, and it's almost empty. Don't get funny with your name. To stand out, stand out. Love this chapter. Kimberly Clark spends millions of dollars a year keeping people from calling tissues Kleenexes. Xerox does the same to keep the word Xerox from becoming a synonym for photocopy. Why the fuss? Because these companies do not want their name to become generic. They want their name to stand for their product. And by the way, from the trademarking perspective, if your trademark becomes generic, it means you no longer own a trademark. It's not your brand, it's no one's brand, it's everyone's brand, it's no longer a trademark. That's the reason why Kleenex and Xerox are fighting really hard to make sure that they preserve ownership over that brand, even though obviously there are so many people out there who use both these names as generic names, but still they haven't lost yet. Same's happening with Google now, right? They want to make sure that Google is a trademark rather than just, well, let me Google that for you. Let me keep reading. Just as sophisticated marketers do not want their brand names to become generic, you don't want a generic name as your brand. A generic name is not your name, it's everyone's. Three Twin Cities companies call themselves Financial Services Inc., Financial Specialists Inc., and Financial Counseling Inc. And by the way, these are corporate names. This is another example of the difference between trademarks and incorporation. And you haven't seen my video on this topic, it's going to be on this channel. Make sure you watch it if you don't really understand the difference between incorporating a name and trademarking the name for your business. So moving on. If someone from Financial Specialists called you, isn't there a great chance that months later you might think that call came from Financial Services? Do you want people not to know who you are, not to remember you, not to be impressed by you immediately, not to be able to tell your company from half a dozen others? Generic names encourage generic business. Love this one. Tell me something I don't know. Among advertising people, it is assumed that companies named creative something are not creative. That's partly because a name like creative design contradicts itself. The name, after all, could not be less creative. The same is true of quality, as in quality cleaners. Doesn't that sound like a cleaner that might break your buttons? Never choose a name that describes something that everyone expects from the service. That name will be generic, forgettable, and meaningless. And I would add to that, merely descriptive trademarks, merely descriptive brands cannot be registered as trademarks. So building a brand around that is building a brand you will never own. So that's just the reality of it. Unless you've got bazillions of dollars so that you put so much money into advertising that you can make a case that after years and years and years of spending millions and millions and millions of dollars, so many people came to associate your descriptive name with you and only you, only then can a descriptive name be trademarked. But it's an uphill climb. You don't want to be running up a down escalator. So very, very good point that Harry makes in this book. Another subchapter, distinctive position, distinctive name. What does the brain remember best? The authors of Brain Book answered this. They studied human memory and concluded that the mind best remembers things that are unique, sensory, creative, and outstanding. Advocates of distinctive names argue that distinctive names are more apt to be remembered, and being remembered often is the key to getting business. Let me repeat that. Being remembered often is the key to getting business. Remember what I've been saying all along. Really, three requirements for building a great brand. It must be memorable. It must be linked to a viable business, because you want to be selling products and services that deliver results that people don't get refunds from all the time. And it has to be well protected. So in this part, Harry talks about memorability of a brand. It has to be distinctive for that to happen. But another argument for distinctive names rests on a basic principle of successful marketing. Make yourself different. The human mind associates. When we hear ordinary names like John Jones, we draw an ordinary association. When we hear distinctive names like Faith Popcorn or Lee Phoenix, we draw distinctive associations. An ordinary name implies just another service. A distinctive name implies a distinctive service, just the impression a service should make. And by the way, from the trademarkability perspective, distinctive names are the easiest to trademark, the easiest to own. And like I always say, different is better than good, unique is better than great. That's exactly what Harry here is talking about. You want to have a distinctive name. In a world filled with Me Too company names, service companies with distinctive names like NameLab, Federal Express, and Prodigy quickly create the association that they're not Me Too services and profit from the association. Be distinctive and sound it. What's in a name? What if Lian Chin's restaurant was called Beijing? Would Lian Chin have made the cover of almost every magazine in Minnesota? No. By naming her restaurant Lian Chin, she ensured that every mention of herself was an ad for her restaurant, and vice versa. By naming her restaurant after herself, Lian Chin made herself a celebrity. Her celebrity made the restaurant more popular. So she started a chain of restaurants. The restaurant's increasing popularity made her more of a celebrity, which made the restaurant even more popular, and on and on. And it's not at all a vicious circle. If you need a name for your service, start with your own. Could be a good idea to build a brand around your personal name. It really depends what you're trying to build, what your exit strategy is and whether your name will still have value for the brand when you're no longer doing it. Right, so there's two approaches to this. One is you want to have your personal name around it. The other one you don't. And there's pros and cons in both, but certainly it's worth considering as one of the options. I'm going to skip a few subchapters and just go straight to this. What brands do for sales. That one is magical. A brand will have three dramatic effects on your selling. First, consider a common occurrence. Someone hears a positive story about a non-branded company. They remember the story, but naturally forget the company's name. So they cannot pass the story on. When the same person hears a story about a brand name service, he remembers the story and the company. So he can pass the story along and does. Word of mouth for a branded service spreads easier and farther, producing more inquiries. This is a great way of putting it. But essentially it's what I've been saying, right? You need to have a memorable name. Because if you don't, nobody's gonna tell about you to their friends, to their relatives. That nobody's going to tell the world about how great you are because nobody can remember your name. Second, a brand single-handedly converts more of these inquiries into clients. Prospects feel more comfortable and less fearful with a brand name. No one ever got fired for choosing IBM, the old saying goes. It applies to choosing brand name services too. For the same amount of selling effort, a branded service makes more sales than a non-branded service. Very true. First, you work for the brand, then the brand works for you. And third, consider the plight of the typical non-branded service. To justify her choice of a non-branded service, a prospective client often must schedule follow-up presentations with the key people in her company or her spouse if it's a consumer service. Frequently, a non-branded service will spend more on this lengthy selling process than the initial project is worth. Branded services rarely face that expense. In fact, prospects routinely choose brand name services virtually sight unseen, so brands take less time and expense to sell. Brand name services can spend less time and money to get more business. This gives them greater profits to reinvest to make their company even more productive and widen the gulf between them and their non-branded competitors. Make selling easier, faster, and cheaper, build a brand, right? And if you think, well, this only goes for big brands, right? Well, big brands started with being smaller brands, being tiny brands, and being nothing at all, right? They all started somewhere. And maybe they have bigger budgets, so they were able to grow faster, but still, they all started with nothing. So if you're just starting out, don't neglect to start building a brand the first day in. And if you're already running a business, if you're already building a brand, make sure to focus on just that. By the way, don't let anyone tell you that your brand is worthless, because it isn't. If you are building a brand that's unique, that's distinctive, that's memorable, it's not worthless. So don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Stand by your brand. It is the tale of the wild world of advertising, perhaps, but the moral often is missed. A hot ad agency emerges. It wins dozens of awards and the adoration of a hungry trade press looking for the newest thing. Eventually, the hot agency wins a big account. If it is good and lucky, the agency keeps that account and wins even more. It becomes a brand. Almost everyone is happy. Everyone except George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy. The team who did all the work for which their agency is taking credit. Flush with confidence, the foursome meet secretly and make a decision. they will haul their Clios, their clippings, and their prodigious talent to a neat loft downtown and build their own hot agency. Remember that George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy comprise the entire team, the account person, media planner, writer, and art director who created those fabulous commercials that made the hot agency hot. They are the people that Coca-Cola trusted with $60 million budget. Does this tale end with our four heroes living happily ever after? Sadly, no. Their new agency gets a nice assignment here and there, but for years, they struggle with tight budgets, fewer clippings, and a growing sense that something is missing. What has happened? George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy still have the talent and experience, but they no longer have the brand. All they have lost is their brand, but the loss is enormous. The four struggle on, thinking that prospective clients will see through the sheer folly of this brand thing and recognize that GEMNN, right? George, Ed, Mary, and Nancy, GEMNN, are really their old brand agency under a new roof and with much lower overhead to boot. And then one Friday, George locks GEMNN's doors behind him for the last time. GEMNN were not beaten by bad planning, the sudden disappearance of their muses, or a U-turn in the economy. They were beaten by a brand, the one they lost and never regained. Never underestimate the value of your brand or the difficulty in creating a new one. This one is so true. Now, this brings me back some frustrating memories, right? As you may know, I used to be a big shot lawyer in a huge law firm, biggest international law firm in the world. They had an office in Moscow, Baker & McKenzie. And I used to do work for all the big names, Apple, Microsoft, DreamWorks, J.K. Rowling, Ford. Now I can go on and on, Sony, Yamaha, on and on and on and on and on. But really, I never thought about this until I left the firm, moved to Canada from Russia, went to law school, started my own law firm, and realized that the reason I was able to do all the work for those clients is because they came for the big law firm, for the law firm's brand. Not Andre's brand, they came for Baker & McKenzie's brand. So when I left, I had to start everything from scratch. I had to start from the point of nobody having a clue who I was, nobody knowing whether I could accomplish, whether I could deliver the results. Nobody knew if I had any experience really because I didn't have a brand. And I started with Mink of Law Corporation, which was probably one of the least creative names you can think of. And then I came up with the name Trademark Factory, and that's when the business took off. But the amount of effort that it took me to build this brand, build Trademark Factory's brand into something that people know about is massive, is huge. So is it impossible to build a brand from scratch? Of course not, because every single brand is built from scratch initially. But as Harry says, never underestimate the value of your brand or the difficulty in creating a new one. It's exactly what happened to me. Now here's another great subchapter. The 400 grand brand. Here's a true story with the names changed to protect the innocent and the fortunate. Two men, Phil and Don, spent 70 years building a contracting company into a solid business. They aren't famous, but they do well enough to order filet mignons without thinking twice. In 1995, another man approached them and offered $400,000 for their business. Again, 1995, when $400,000 was still a lot of money. Phil and Don's contracting company had no inventory, no proprietary products or services, no patents or copyrights, and only one employee other than Phil and Don. The company rented a storefront and owned no real estate, no capital assets, and no accounts receivable. a thorough accounting, in fact, would have revealed that the $400,000 company's only assets were its name and client list. What was the buyer offering to buy? Was it the client list? It couldn't be. Clients use the company's service only once or twice in a lifetime. Repeat business wasn't much better than in funeral parlors. Moreover, the client list had value only if the clients thought that although the old owners were no longer with the company would still provide the same high quality. In other words, those old clients and any new ones were simply buying the brand. And that is what the businessman offered $400,000 for too. A $400,000 brand built in just 7 years with relatively little investment. For years, AMRE, a Dallas-based provider of vinyl siding, paid Sears $30 million each year, more than seven times AMRE's net profit, to license Sears' brand name. As a result, and because of the consumer's confidence in the Sears name, and by the way, as you can tell, it's an older book, and so Sears' name at that time was something that meant something to a lot of people. So as a result, and because of the consumer's confidence in the Sears name, AMRE was able to mark up each siding sale 2.5 times, far over industry norms. In 1995, AMRE realized there was a good brand with a much lower price and struck a 20-year, $230 million licensing agreement with Century 21. There you go. Kraft sold for 8 times its book value. Experts agreed that the only explanation was the enduring power and enormous value of the Kraft brand. What is a brand worth? Should you try to build one? Thousands, millions, then billions. And emphatically, yes, a brand is money. Brands in a microwave world. You want a new sound system. Because you love music and hate wasting money on large purchases, you want to choose wisely. But you also have 8 calls to return, a lawn to mow, 1 recital, and 3 little league practices. You are, in short, the typical got no time American. You cannot buy more time, so you must give some up. You need shortcuts. You need some way to speed your decision on that sound system. Fortunately, you find your shortcut, a brand name system. Brands are decision-making shortcuts in a world of people like you looking for shortcuts. Often, a brand is all the information some people will need to choose their next sound system, even though at least one unbranded system is clearly superior and 30% cheaper than the system they choose. How true is that? How do you buy your car? How do you buy your phone? How do you buy your clothes? How do you buy anything? You buy it through the brand. In choosing a brand name sound system, you demonstrate a rule of modern marketing. As time shrinks, the importance of brands increases. And time in America is shrinking. Companies have downsized their staffs and upsized the workloads of all the survivors. These people need shortcuts every walking minute. They turn to service and product brands. So give your prospects a shortcut. Give them a brand. Love it. If nothing else, think of your brand as shortcut to make it easier for your target market to pick you among everyone else who does exactly the same thing as you do. Brands and the power of the unusual. Try this test. The following are most of the great brand names of the English-speaking world. A few brands have been overlooked, although being overlooked says something about the brand. Harley Davidson, Sony, Honda, Procter & Gamble, Nike, Levi Strauss, Rolls-Royce, Disney, Xerox, Kleenex, Coca-Cola, Mercedes-Benz, Lloyds of London, Nikon, Harvard, Kodak, Microsoft, Marlboro. What is striking about this list? It is how unusual these names are. So we go back to having an unusual name. Virtually no one or nothing else carries any of these names. You know, no other Sony, Disney, Harvard, Kodak, or Harley. Unless you studied mythology and recognized the goddess Nike, most of the great brand names are unconfusable. People associate those brand names only with the companies behind them. The names have no bad associations created by their connection to something else with the same name. To speed up the building of your brand, choose an unconfusable name. So that's what Harry Beckwith writes about brands in his amazing book, Selling the Invisible. And like I said, if you haven't read the book, if you're thinking of offering services, if you are offering services, you gotta read the book. It's just so great. It makes it so much easier to understand why you've been struggling with offering services to the world. And it's not a coincidence that he spent so much time talking about the importance of a brand, especially with services, because services are intangible, right? There's no way to touch the product before you get to experience the product, because there is nothing tangible around it. And that's what makes brands even more important for our services. So here are the main takeaways. You gotta have a brand. You gotta be building a brand. You can't build a successful business without building a brand for it. The brand needs to be unique, because that will help you position your products or services as unique, and it also will make it easier for you to own and protect that brand so that nobody else would claim any rights to a brand similar to yours. And you don't have to be funny. You don't have to come up with some clever names. You don't have to, try to come up with generic names or descriptive names. What you want to do is you want to come up with a unique name and make it great over time. Something I've been saying over and over again. It's not about coming up with an amazing brand. It's about coming up with a unique brand and making it great and amazing over time. And of course, once you've come up with a brand name that you feel is connecting with your target audience, you feel it's something you're going to be spending your time, money, and efforts trying to build, you got to protect it, right? As our tagline goes, if it's worth promoting, it's worth protecting. Right? You may be testing your brand, and if you're not sure, then yeah, maybe that's not a good time for you to trademark it. But as soon as you make the decision that that's the brand I want to be promoting, I'm going to be going out there, I'm going to be doing advertising, I'm going to be shooting videos, I'm going to be telling people about the brand, and I want the people to associate my business with that brand, that's the perfect moment for you to go out there and make sure that you trademark your brand, that you own that brand that you've been working on. Now, I hope you found this useful, and it's kind of a different type of video. I thought that would be helpful when I find great books of others and find pieces there that talk about brands, that talk about marketing and how brands can help you with your marketing, how brands can help you with your business, how brands can make you make your dreams come true. So if you like this one, please comment below. I need to have your feedback as to whether you want more videos like this, less videos like this. And if you haven't yet, subscribe now, because we post a new video on brands, on trademarks every single day. And if you like this one, you're probably gonna like more than just this one video. So for now, that's it. I'll see you in the next video.